I'm headed to the Filmmakers Cooperative in New York City to meet film archivists and historians Jon Gartenberg and Jeff Capp.
Hey, how you guys doing?
Hey.
Jeff describes the images in one of the albums as a who's who of up-and-coming actors and directors of the day.
This is major talent. Edgar Jones, Evelyn Nesbitt Thaw, and this here is Marie Dressler. This has got to be from the teens. In the early 30s, she was about the biggest star in Hollywood.
Who was this Siegmund Lubin?
Siegmund Lubin was an early film pioneer. He came over from Germany, and he set up an optician shop in Philadelphia. But
John explains how the immigrant found himself at the center of the new film industry located on the East Coast.
Before Hollywood started, there was the invention of the motion pictures in the 1890s, which was basically based around New York. So you had studios like Biograph and Edison in New York, and Vitagraph built a studio in Brooklyn, and SNA was in Chicago, and Lubin, who was an early film pioneer, set up shop in Philly.
So you're telling me that Philadelphia was part of the birth of film?
Absolutely, because he started in the 1890s with his whole film business, so he was really a big part of what went on. And he was actually like the first Jewish movie pioneer, even 15 years before Goldwyn and other people got in the business.
Really?
Yeah.
The city of brotherly love exposed the optician to some cutting-edge technological developments.
Philadelphia is a real center of sort of scientific activity. So he sees, for example, the motion experiments that Edward Muybridge does for the University of Pennsylvania. He's familiar with lenses, and he decided to get into the movie business. It was like behind the scenes.
John says the faces in this album also represent a new development in cinema, the birth of the movie star.
That around 1910 or so, stars became to be known in the cinema. Spectators in the theater were starting to recognize who are these stars, and they wanted to see them in the movies.
The appetite for celebrity was fed by Lubin's increasingly complex operation.
He did everything from shooting movies, distributing movies, building theaters to show movies.
John explains that Lubin's integrated operation and economies of scale made his films faster and cheaper to produce than his competitors.
Lubin would also copy films that other companies made and put them out as his own. It's very rough and tumble. Everybody wanted to get in the business and everybody wanted to make money.
But Lubin wasn't the only filmmaker fighting for an edge.
Edison was trying to control everything by controlling the patents on all the cameras and the projectors.
Eventually, John says Lubin, Thomas Edison, and other film pioneers joined forces and created the Motion Picture Patents Company.
Basically what they said is, look, we're all fighting with each other, we're all losing a lot of money, so let's just all get together and let's control the business ourselves.
So they created a monopoly?
Yes.
But what about the mysterious farm scenes in our album and guys decked out in cowboy gear?
What about this one from the Bettswood Ranch?
John explains that in 1912, running out of space, Lubin bought Bettswood, a sprawling suburban estate belonging to a local brewer.
He started building around 1912, and by 1914 was like the most advanced studio of all the film companies in the United States.
Bettswood became the movie lot for scores of westerns. Jeff and John are staggered that such a record of the Lubin studio has been found. A fire in 1914 destroyed most of Lubin's early films.
In some instances, these still photographs may be the only record that exists of some of these productions.
I'm particularly interested in Herbert Lubin.
Well, I've never heard of him, and it's very hard to tell from this book. I don't recognize him as a name, and you know
yeah,
actors
no,
pretty
I,
well.
I don't think that it's even certain that he was an actor.
To get a better sense of Lubin's work, and maybe a glimpse of Billy's relative, they suggest I track down some of Lubin's remaining films.